today we're going to do some transcription. We're going to take songs that are in a one particular meter and transcribe it to a different meter, a different time signature. Okay. Now, even though I guess I forgot to leave in the there was another introduction right here. That's why it had time signature in it. So I just cut out everything but the treble clef. All right, so let's go ahead and first you want to do why we do transcription like this. Well, there's a number of reasons, but the reason why I'm doing it is to more easily explain how time signatures work, how meters work, simple and compound meter. In this particular case, we're in simple meter, where the beat can be evenly divided. So the whole notes in simple meter would become two half notes. If you split them, they're evenly divided. So a whole note, you cut it in two, or you split it, you subdivide it, and it'll become two half notes. A half note, if you subdivide it, it'll become two quarter notes. A quarter note, if you subdivide it, will become two eighth notes. This all happens in the same space, right? So in the time of a half note would take up, if you subdivided it, it would be two quarter notes. In a quarter note, if you subdivide it, in the same amount of time that a quarter note takes up, you'd have two eighth notes. And then eighth notes subdivided into 16th notes. Everything's even. Whereas compound time, the time signatures are like 6/8, 9/4, 12/8, those kind of things, 6/9 and 12 at the top. Those beats, when you subdivide them, they split into three parts. Compound time, the beat is in triplets. All right, so let's continue this one in simple time. We are in 4/4 time. Like I say, I cut out the measure that had the time signature at the top, at the beginning, excuse me. But I'm having a hard time talking this morning. Oh, my goodness. Anyway. All right, so let's go ahead and count the rhythm first. And we'll transcribe this into another time signature, and that'll hopefully help you see how the beats work and how time signatures work. All right, so this is a 4/4 time. That means there's four beats in the measure, and the four at the bottom tells me that the quarter note is what gets the beat or the count. All right, so if I look at this measure, I can see every measure needs four beats. So that is one beat, that's a beat, and that's a beat, and that's a beat. Now, the reason why these are all crammed together, and this one has a lot of space, because there were some lyrics down here, and the lyrics took up. When you put lyrics on these songs, that'll change like the balance of the measure where the beats lie a lot, many times. That's why I don't start off with students by counting and looking at measures that have lyrics, because the lyrics can change. Lyrics are important so that they change the balance of the measure. But in this case, I can easily see there's a beat. That's equal to a quarter note. That is a quarter note. That's equal to a quarter note. And there's a quarter note. So there's the four beats. So here's beat one right here. I put in parentheses because there's no music there, but it definitely is the downbeat. And this is and this will be beat two, because there's all of beat one. Here's beat two. Here's beat three. And I'm putting parentheses in front of it to show that's where the beat lies, but there's actually nothing happening there. And then and here, that's the second half of the third beat. And then here's all of the fourth beat. Okay. Same thing here in this measure. The reason why these are coming down is because there was a bass clef here and they were connected. Normally, if you just have one line of music, you don't have the bar lines don't go past the lines. So that would be not there. But in this case, it is because I just cut that out. Here's the downbeat. So that's one. And that would be, oh, brother. The parentheses would be around the one. And then here's the second beat. And here's the third beat. Now, there's two 16th notes, which take up the same amount of space as an eighth note. And how you count 16th notes, in case you've not watched any of my other videos or you don't know, it's number, and then E and A. And there's all where the eighth note is, so it's the number, typically. And then we put E because we're not to the second half of the beat yet. Here's the second half of the beat, starts right here. So if there's our eighth notes, there would be eighth note here and an eighth note here. Well, in this case, we've got them mixed. You got an eighth note here, which take up this space. And then here's this 216, this would be right here. So this would be 3 and a, because this takes up the space of where the, of all the and. If it was just an eighth note, it would be and. All right, there's an and. All right. So, it, but we have two notes there in the same space that just an eighth note would be. So we have to say and a, because there's two. You can't just go and four, because there's four right there. All right, so there's four, but since it's a tied note, and the note the note is continuing sounding across, we're also going to put a parentheses around it to show, yeah, there's a note here, but we're, you know, we're not doing anything. We're just holding it. And that's how we do it. That's how I do it. So now I know, okay, this is where the beat is. You know, I can see where all the beats are easily. This next measure would be one in parentheses. Now here's 2/16th notes. So this is the second half of the beat. So one, so that starts on and, because there's all of the first half. That's one E. If those are 16th notes, that'd be one E. Well, this is and So it'd be and because this is all of the first half of the beat, and this is the second half. And that's how 16th notes work. This is the first half of the beat, and that's the second half of the beat. Where the and starts is where the second half of the beat starts, when you divide them in two, like this, 2/8 notes. One and two and. This is one E and two E and, okay? So this is the case. This would be one and two and three and four and, okay? All right, now we're going to transcribe this thing. We're going to pick a time signature that something else other than the chord note gets the beat. All right. So I'm going to, and I'll tell you what, well, yeah, go ahead. If I was transcribing this, let's say, instead of 4/4 time, let's make it in 4/8 time. All right, 4/8 time. So there's four beats in the measure, and the eighth note is going to get the beat. And this is very common, especially in the 1800s and the late 1700s, maybe even earlier than that. I, off the top of my head, I can't remember that. But I do know that that in the 1800s, that piano music especially was written in 4/8 time and 3/8 time. And you'll even have fine music in more modern times where you have these different time signatures where something other than the chord note gets the beat, fairly common. All right, so let's count this. Let's write this in as if it were in 4/8 time. So now we're still gonna follow this rhythm right here that we counted out. We wrote it out, the rhythm. And so we're going to redo this though, but we're gonna do it in 4/8 time, okay? So in 4/8 time, one and, you have eighth rest here. But instead of an eighth rest, because if the eighth note getting the beat, then if you, in simple time, the beat is evenly divided, you divide it two, you'd have two, not eighth notes, you'd have 2/16th notes. And this time signature, 4/8 time, one and two and three and four are all 16th notes. Right? The beat's still going, but instead of quarter notes, they're eighth notes. Now, if you've not had a lot of experience with music, you might find that very odd, but the fact is, there's a lot of music written in those time signatures. In fact, one of the most famous ones I can think of off the top of my head is Fürerlied by Beethoven. That's in 3/8 time. Those aren't quarter notes, those are eighth notes. So when you look at that music, there's 16th notes and 32nd notes all over the place. And I'm not sure all the reasons why all these different time signatures have come into historical use. You know, you look back in history, but I do know that if it's like today, somebody does something different or unusual at some point, and enough people think it's cool enough that they all start doing it, and it becomes a thing, you know? And that's just true of most music, you know? Us composers, we're always trying to do something different and makes theory people frustrated because now the theory people have to figure it out, how to explain it to people. Anyway, all right, so we're going to make this a 16th rest, like two little nibs on it, two little flags. Those aren't flags, sorry, nibs. And then this would be a 16th note down here on the E. All right. So that has two flags. Flags always fly to the right. This would be an eighth note, right? To put a flag here. This would be a 16th. rest on the third beat, and then this would be a 16th note, C, and then that A and C would be an eighth note. All right. I'm standing behind the camera, so this is not easy trying to do this accurately. All right, so now we have parentheses 1 and 2, and this would be 3 and 4, right there. The eighth note gets the beat. This also would be a 16th rest. Have you already got this figured out? You already written it down? And that'd be a 16th note because it's only half a beat. But here would be two 16th notes. Two beams. And then this, you got a 16th note. And this would be 32nd notes. Just like I was telling you about in Fugue Release, how they use a lot of 32nds, because anything that's, you know, like 1E-end to 2E-end is going to have, it's going to be 32nds. So I got to add another beam. I should have done that differently, but anyway, sorry. All right, so there we have da, di, da. So this is going to be an eighth note. It's okay if you figure, you know, try to work on this ahead of me. That way when you get to, you'll see, oh, did I do that right or not? And then this last one would be 16th. That's the one parenthesis. So this anda down here would be 32nd. So that's one. That's the 16th. That's 32nd. And then, for sake of time, I'm not going to write all the notes. I'll just write the melody. There's just 16th notes. And then some more 16th notes. All right. These would all be 16th notes. Now I'm going to beam all these together as well. Now, remember, in 4-4 time, it's quite acceptable to beam all the notes of the last two measures and the first two measures. And actually, in 4-8 time, anything that has 8 at the bottom, like 3-8 time, 4-8 time, it's very common. If everything in the measure are subdivided beats, beam the whole measure together. It's one of the only times you do that. Is where the eighth note gets the beat, and it's usually in 3-8 time more. But you see it in 4-8 time too. I shouldn't have said that. But you see it 4-8 time. All right. So here's one from 4-4 time to 4-8 time. All right. Here's another song, and you might know these songs. I mean, I took these last two. They're from the Greatest Showman, that musical. All right, and. This one also is in 4-4 time. Di-da-da-di-da-da-da-da-da-da. And a two, and a. So I'm counting this is going to be one in parentheses. That's all of beat. I mean, that's the first half of beat one. Let's say this is in 4-4 time. And this is going to be 1E. And this is the two 16th notes. It's going to start on and. But then I have another note still in that half of the beat. I haven't gotten to beat two yet, which is right here. So I got to call it something. So, it does. So remember, 16th notes are 1E and a. So this would be 1E. There's the first two in that eighth rest. This would be and a. So and a. So two 16th notes. Beat. This is all the beat right here. That's all the first beat right here. All right. So and a two. That's the eighth note. So that's the first half. Two more 16th notes on the second half of the beat. So this would be and again, but it's tied over to this beat. So beat three has no, we don't sail in it again. It's holding on. And then this would also be and. And here, once again, a tie, beat four. I'm going to put parentheses around it because we're not playing it again. It's holding. And then and it also ties over to here. So I'll put a one in parentheses. Now I don't show a distinction between sustained notes and rest. And if you want to, that's fine. I mean, the parentheses thing is not a big deal. I just like to show, oh, remind you, oh, you remember there's nothing, you don't sing or say something over here. You let it ride or you rest. Seems to be helpful, especially beginning students. And also we have beat 2, we have a beat 3, and there nothing's happening, so I'll put parentheses around them. But on beat 4, something happens, 4, and then we have another anda again with a tie. And over here you can see it's carries over for one whole beat. Ooh, can't we get down here? Okay, so all right, so let's transcribe this to another meter. All right, now here's a meter that has been common at times in the past, still is, but not as much as like 4/4 time is you've seen, and that is four. I'm gonna put this in 4/2 time. All right, 2 time. So instead of 4/4 time, where the quarter note gets the beat, and there are 4 beats in the measure, in this time signature, the half note gets the beat, and there are 4 beats. All right. So think about this. If I want to get rest and two and if I want to get the same rhythm, then but that half note is getting the beat. It's actually getting the beat. You might say, well, that looks weird. Well, if you're playing band, you would go, well, that's pretty normal. We play things in cut time all the time where the half note gets the beat. And a lot of choral works you'll see in something where the half note gets the beat. But anyway, let's try that, okay? So if I want one and, what would one and in 4/2 time look like? Well, if the half note's getting the beat in 4/2 time, the half note's getting the beat. All right, so that's the beat. So that's one. Well, then one and is going to look like this. That's one and two and three and. It's funny if you're not used to that, you know, that way of thinking. But it's very common in a lot of music to have this getting the beat. It wouldn't surprise me at some point in the future, pop music, people start doing that, because that's usually how it works. Stuff comes back, comes around, you know. Something that was cool, then it fell out of favor, and it comes back, you know, 100 years later. Anyway, so if this is one and two and, so what is one eanda? What is four notes that happen on a beat if the half note gets the beat? Well, it would be eighth notes. All right. And if you're used to going, well, that's one and two and, well, in this time signature where the half note's getting the beat, and the quarter notes would be counted one and two, because they're the subdivision, right? Half notes subdivided is two parts, and they're both quarter notes. And that would be one, if the beat's half note, this is one, so this is going to be one and two and, right? So this is going to be one E and a two E and a three E and a four E, and that's what that would look like. So we have to know that, because we're going to come over and it's got a lot of andas in here, right? So this over a little bit. So since there's nothing happening, that's the first half of the beat. So what's the first half of the beat? Well, it's a quarter note. So we're gonna put a quarter rest in here instead of a note, a rest, because that's just the first half of the beat. So this would be what? It would be 2/8 notes. All right. So that's anda in 4/2 time. So then we have two andas. So what would two andas? Well, two, we know the first half of the beat is going to be an eighth note, I mean a quarter note, because that's how something with a half note is a beat. That's what the anda, that's what a subdivided beat looks like. So there's the first half. So this would be 2/16 notes. And this would be tied over to a quarter note. And then you'd have two what? 2/8 notes, right? And then tie it over to another quarter note. And then this will be 2/8 notes. This will be tied over to a quarter note. Excuse me, to a half note. Did you catch that before I did? All right, so that'd be a half note, because that's the beat. And then here would be, what kind of rest would be down here? Well, it'd be a half rest, which is a little box that sits on that third line. Got to be careful not to make them too big, because then they look like a breve rest, a double whole note rest. Right, so you have to do this little box. All right, then this will be four and, well, we've already done this so many times, quarter note, and then an eighth, and then it ties over. Right. So now I have the exact same rhythm, but it looks different. And I know, you know, you think, why do they do it all the same? So, well, because for a lot of reasons, but one, composers don't like to do the same thing over and over again. We don't like to do it. We're always trying to find something new and fresh or something different. I think, personally, that composers are basically people that we would now describe as being ADD, ADHD, or something like that. We get bored easily or something. I was trying to do something different. All right. And those and theory people tend to be people who are, I mean, the ones I've known, and I'm even that way a little bit, you know. You like seeing things orderly, and you like making sense of them. And, you know, that's just how it is. All right. So let's do this. We're still in 4-2 time, right? So here's a beat. That's a whole beat. So beat one. Now look at this. Let's talk about this for a second. This is 4-4, right? This is 4-4 time. So you've got a 16th rest, an 8th note, and a 16th note right here. This is all beat 2 right here. That's all of beat 2. But the 16th notes and 8th notes got a little mixed up. But this is a very common rhythm. That da 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 da. That's very common. And in rock, jazz, even pop music now, even worship songs in church. You get a lot of these kind of syncopated 16th patterns. All right, so you've got, this is the downbeat, so we have to put a 2 here because that's the beginning of the beat right there, the beginning of the second beat. But this is hopping in right after that 16th note rest, 16th rest. Well, whatever happens after that 16th note or rest, whatever happens right after that is going to be an E, right? It's going to be E. To E, well, the and would be in here someplace. But see, since that's an eighth note, it's holding over that. So I'm not going to put anything down there. The only time I put parentheses around anything is beats, numbers. 1, 2, 3, or 4, that's it. Or 1, 2, or whatever the beats are. Not on the E's and the ands and those kind of things, because it's just not worth it. I just want to see where the beat is when you're writing it down or when you're counting out loud. You know, oh, a parentheses, I'm not going to say that. You know, but I know it's there. I know the beat's there. All right. So 2 E and is in here. So that would be the or the 16th note pattern. 2 E, and it's also tied over to beat 3, right? Now, this is an 8th note. All right. So that's all of beat 3. I mean, excuse me. That's the first half of beat 3. I really need to wake up before I do this. All right. So that's an 8th note. Now, look at this. A 16th rest and a 16th note. Yeah. And you'll see that occasionally. And what happens is, instead of making this a flag, and then a 16th rest and a 16th note, instead of doing it like this, and then the 16th rest, could have done it that way. But this way, it helps us see, oh, that's the beat. We still know that's a 16th note, and we know that's a quarter note. But instead of having a dot here, so what you would normally see, you see this, or you, if they wanted that to sound like short, that do da. See, they wanted a little teeny bit of space here, whoever wrote this song. All right, so nothing's happening here. Even though it has this beam across it, there's really nothing happening right then. 3 on the and, there's nothing, but we have a note. So when you were playing this or singing it, you'd have a teeny bit of a space where that 16th note be. Now, it depends on how fast the song is, whether you'd really hear it or not. If it's going slow, you would hear it. If you're going really fast, you might not hear it, really. Anyway, but that's a one way of writing this. There's two ways that it could have been written. It could have been written like this, which is the more common one. A dotted 8th note of 16th. But in this case, they actually wanted this little bit of a space, so that's how they wrote it. And they kept the beam in, so the whole beat can be easily seen. So this is 4. A 4 E and a. All right. So that's 3, 3, a 4 E and a. All right. So that'd be 4 E and a. So there's beat 4. All of beat 4 right there. All right. All right. So let's go ahead and transcribe this into 4-2 time. Right? So we want the same rhythm pattern, but the note's gonna look different. All right, because we're cool and we want to do it in a cool way. All right. All right, so B1 in 4-2 time is going to be a half note, because the half note gets the beat in this time signature. All right. And then nothing's happening on right on the downbeat, but what part, remember in 4-2 time, what gets the four, you know, when the eighth notes are subdivided? Well, they can't be here. I mean, quarter notes are subdivided in 4-2 time. In 4-2 time, when the quarter notes are subdivided, you get eighth notes. So this is going to be an eighth rest. And then you're going to have, look at this. Instead of an eighth note, this is an eighth note. So this is half of a beat in 4-4 time. That's a half of a beat right there. But it just happens to come on the E part of the beat. So down here, this would become, have you got it figured out yet? A quarter note. Mm-hmm. And this would be an eighth note. Now you can't beam those together because you can't beam a quarter note. You can't beam a quarter note with it because it didn't have a beam. It doesn't have any flags. You can only beam notes that have flags. So you can beam eighth notes and 16th notes together. You can beam 32nd notes together with eighth notes and with six. Those all have flags. But you can't beam a quarter note or a half note to anything else because it doesn't have a flag. All right? Only notes have flags in them. So this doesn't have a flag. So that's just how it's got to be. That's the beat. There's no way of sort of showing, oh, look, see this beam? This beams them all together. Well, it doesn't. You can't do that on this particular time signature, which is one of the weaknesses, I think, of anything with a half note of the beat. But typically, notes that have a lot of syncopation in it and a lot of notes happening on a beat, and, you know, 4-4 time is just a better way of doing it. Easy to read. All right, so it's tied over to another eighth, so that would be a quarter. And then you have this. Now here we have to do, like I say, there's no flag here, so we can't beam it together like they did here. No flags. We can't beam them together. So this D would be, it's a 16th note, but it would be an eighth note down here. And then you have four of these on one beat. So what does that look like in 4-2 time? Well, I'm going to do this and let you figure it out. Yep, all eighth notes. Do, 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 do. I got my stems a little too long there. I should have gone down a little lower that. But anyway, so this is tied over. Now look at this. We just talked about this. But instead of there being a rest at the beginning of the beat, this actually has a note on the beginning of the beat. All right. So this would be a what? It would be instead of a 16th, it would be an 8. And this would be a quarter. And this would be an 8th. Now, this is still all one beat because the beat figure is a half note. The beat is a half note. So this is all one beat. And then this would all be one beat. So that'd be 4 eighth notes. Right? I'm not going to write it because I ran out of room.